Great. Well, thanks once again, team. It's fantastic. I was checking out a few interesting jobs on the internet the other day. Not for me personally, but just for a bit of fun. So maybe if you're looking for a job, here's a few options that you can think about. I'm not sure if they're all available in the Hawke's Bay, but these were some possible jobs going around the world. You could be an ice cream taster. How about that? I could enjoy doing that for like a couple of days, but I wouldn't want to make a full-time career out of that one. If you're the kind of person who likes to stand around and do nothing all day, you could be a live mannequin. How about that? Just like standing in a store doing that. Being a cruise ship entertainer, I'm sure that would be kind of fun if you enjoy going for a cruise and don't get seasick. You could be a fake Facebooker, which I don't understand all of that, but I think you make a fake Facebook profile and then somehow you use it to catch other people out, whatever it is, I don't know. But if you're into that kind of thing, it could be fun. Or you could be a professional ethical hacker, which is actually a good guy who would be somebody who would test a company's new software to make sure that it can't be hacked by the bad guys. That would be what the good hackers would do. Here's an interesting one. How would you like to be a knife thrower's assistant? Guaranteed to last a lifetime. So, or here's one that I don't think I would ever want to do, and I'm sure you wouldn't, but an odor tester. I'm not quite sure what kind of odors they're smelling, but anyway, that was the job that they do. I'm guessing it's something to do with deodorants and perfumes and that kind of thing. But anyway, on the 5th of March 1984, that was a significant date in my life because it was the first day of my working career. Back in that year, 1984, I had gone back to start school. I'd gone to the seventh form as it was in those days, it's year 13 this time. But to be honest, I only went back to school not for the education but for the sport, and so I played tennis for a month or so, and when the tennis competition finished, I was happy to quit school. In fact, I was, to be honest, sick of school. I had no desire to go to university back then or do anything like that. I didn't want my education to get in the way of my life, so I quit school, and I managed to pick up a job as a telephone technician working for the post office, as it was called back then, which became Telecom, which is now Spark. And so I became a telephone technician in Martin, of all places. And then I spent the next 11 years as a telephone technician. And most of that time, actually, I was working over in Palmerston North before. So that was for 11 years. And then I set sail after that for California and went to seminary back in 1995. And by God's grace, and thankfully, God has enabled me to be involved in full-time church ministry for the last 17 years of my life. And I say all of that because some people think that pastors have no idea what happens in the real world. They have no idea what happens in the real workforce. And I guess I want you to be aware that I understand what it's like. I understand what it's like to be employed by a secular employer. I understand what it's like to have to work an 8-to-5 job. I also understand what it's like to have to do shift work and work weekends and work Saturdays and work Sundays and evenings and even work that horrible doggo shift from 11 p.m. at night to 7 a.m. in the morning. I understand that stuff. I know what it was like to work for a boss that was tough, one that had high expectations, that watched you like a hawk and looked at his watch when you walked in the door at 8 o'clock or 1 minute past 8 or 1 minute to 8 in the morning. I know what it was like to work for a boss who wasn't very well liked by some of the staff. I also know what it was like to work for a boss who was perhaps too generous and was maybe a little bit lax in his standards and in his management style. I also understand what it's like to work in an environment where job satisfaction was at a low ebb when everybody had the threat of redundancies hanging around their head. I also know what it's like to work with unbelieving workmates who show up on a Monday morning and they want to describe to you in detail all of their sinful activities throughout the weekend. I know what it's like to come back from having a cup of coffee and look at the clock and it's 10 past or quarter past 10 in the morning, and there's still an hour and three quarters to go until lunchtime, and the day just is going to drag on and on. Doesn't happen in this role, I can tell you that, but it used to happen at telecom sometimes. I also know what it's like to work 40 hours a week, but then also on top of that have to work 10 or 20 or 30 hours a week for the church. I understand that. And I'm thankful for those experiences, thankful that the Lord was able to provide for me in all of those different ways. And I say all of that because today's message is for those of us who are workers serving as employees in the workforce. And so I invite you to take your Bibles this morning, if you haven't already, and turn with me to Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. And the reason why we're dealing with this subject this morning is because it is the next theme in a series that we've been having here at Onikawa Bible Church over the past few months. We've been tracking through this New Testament book, this New Testament letter called Titus. And it's a very, very practical book. There's so many helpful principles that we've already learned in this particular book, and helpful guidelines for older men, older women, for younger men, for younger women. Last week we looked at the importance of being a godly testimony in our lives. As Christians, we need to be a shining example of a Christian in our world as people are watching us. And so today it's another very practical passage as well. And so Titus chapter 2, I just want to read to you the two verses that we're looking at today. Titus 2, verse 9 and verse 10. It says this: "Bondservants are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. They are to be well-pleasing, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior." Just a couple of really practical verses for us to think about this morning. But let me start, first of all, just with a word about slavery, because notice what it says there. It says bondservants in verse 9, or some translations will say bond slaves, or will just say slaves. Because when this letter was written back in the first century, slavery was very common in the Roman Empire. Some people have estimated that there were something like 50 million slaves who were serving in the Roman Empire back in the first century. And some would say that in Rome itself, in the city of Rome, that a third of the population of Rome were slaves. Now, unlike slavery in America in the 18th and 19th centuries, slavery in the first century was completely unrelated to race. And it was not just the uneducated or the socially deprived that were slaves. I mean, in the first century, some of the slaves were well-educated. They were skillful. In fact, some of the slaves worked as domestic servants. Some of them worked as farm laborers. Some worked as craftsmen. Some worked as teachers. Some were soldiers. Some were managers. And some slaves were even doctors. Now, some of the slaves were born into slavery. Others, in that they chose to be slaves because it would guarantee a home and food for them. Others were kidnapped and they were forced into slavery. Others were sold by their parents into slavery. And some of the slaves were treated very well in those days, and some were treated harshly. Some were abused. In fact, some slaves in those days were able to earn their freedom just through faithful service. But the most common trait of slavery in those days, if you were a slave, you were under the absolute authority of your master. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks of the year, you were under the authority of your master. And for those of you who were here a few months ago, you remember we looked at the book of Philemon. And Philemon is all about a slave called Onesimus. He was a runaway slave, and in those days, if a slave ran away from his master and he was caught, he could be imprisoned or he could be branded with an F, sometimes on his forehead to say that he was a fugitive. Sometimes if he was caught, he was tortured. Even some slaves were killed if they were caught after running away. But as we open up the book of Titus this morning, we see the author of Titus, Paul, he is speaking about slavery because it was a major part of that first century culture. And it's obvious by reading this letter that many slaves in those days had become Christians, and they made up a significant part of the churches in that place, and especially in this place of Crete where Titus was living. Now, Paul, when he writes about this, he doesn't condone slavery, and at the same time, he actually doesn't condemn it. He simply gives New Testament instructions to the slaves who were Christians and also to the masters who were Christians, because there were both masters and slaves in the churches in that culture in those days. But in giving instructions to them, and especially as Paul gave instructions to the masters, he really did lay a foundation for the extinction of slavery. Because Christian masters were to treat their slaves with kindness, and they were to be fair, and they were to be just in their dealing with their slaves. And some of you will be familiar with that verse in Galatians 3:28 that says that there is neither male nor female, there is neither Jew nor Gentile, there is neither slave nor free. When you are a Christian, we are all in Christ. We are all one in Christ. We are all equal spiritually in the eyes of God, whether you're a Jew or Gentile, whether you're a slave or whether you're a free person. And so the outworking of the gospel, the outworking of the teaching of the New Testament, was instrumental in abolishing slavery. But we have to fast forward 2,000 years, because obviously we don't live in a master-slave society. So the question is for us this morning, does a passage like this that's addressed to slaves have any relevance for us in the 21st century? Because we, as readers of this letter, we live in freedom. Does it have any relevance for us? And I would say yes, it does. Because the principles that we can pull out of this text are very applicable in a relationship where an employee voluntarily submits himself or herself to the authority of their employer. Now, admittedly, the situation is slightly different today, in that an employee today can quit their job or resign or terminate their employment and terminate that relationship with their employer at any time. Obviously, in the first century, a slave could never do that. He was permanently under the authority of his master. So it's not an exact parallel, but there are very many similarities and principles that we can draw from the text. And so for us today, to help it be relevant for us, I just want us to look at this text, and I find in this text that there are five qualities or five characteristics of a Christian employee or a Christian worker. So Paul's got some specific words for those of you who are working in the workforce, and it's very, very practical. The first thing I want us to notice is that bondservants, it says in verse 9, are to be submissive to their own masters in everything. So the first point is this: you need to be submissive. You need to be submissive. Now, this was a very common theme even in the New Testament, because Paul dealt with masters and slaves in a number of the letters that he wrote. If you went to the book of Ephesians, you would see there that Paul says to the bondservants, he says, you are to obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart as you would Christ. And if you flipped over to the book of Colossians, you'd see a similar message there. Paul says to the bondservants, he says, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service or people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. And then you could go to 1 Peter as well. Later on, Peter writes about slaves as well. He says, servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. So a number of times we see in the New Testament, there are instructions given to slaves who were Christians. And so for us today, this simply means as a Christian employee, we must be willing to obey our boss no matter what. We have to be willing to obey them and submit to them. It really doesn't matter if your boss is the nicest person on the planet, or whether your boss is the king or queen of nastiness, you still need to submit to them and to their authority. Because that's always God's plan. that we would always submit to those who are in authority over us. You can look down, if you've got your Bible open, to chapter 3, verse 1. It's the same principle there. You need to submit to authority. We need to submit to our government. We need to submit to our teachers. We need to submit to our parents. We need to submit here, in this context, to our employers. So in the workplace, you need to willingly obey your team leader or your manager or your CEO or whatever their title might be. Christians ought not to be the ones leading a revolt in the workplace. They shouldn't be the ones who are rebellious against their authority. And by the way, as I said, it really doesn't matter if your boss is considered to be harsh or biased or unfair or prejudiced in any way, the principle is you still need to submit to them. Think about those slaves, those Christian slaves in the first century. They were called to submit to their masters, even if their masters were unjust. So we still need to submit. And this is not a call to submit reluctantly with a grudge. No, this is to submit with the right attitude, not with a bad attitude, but with a right attitude that pleases God. And I'm not saying this is always easy. I understand it can be a challenge, but to submit with the right attitude is what God would expect us to do. He would want us to obey with a heart of worship towards God. He would want us to submit. Those verses earlier said, fearing the Lord. That means revering the Lord, choosing to worship God in our submission. And it's to be done, according to this verse, in everything. In everything. Not just in some things that we want to submit to, but in everything. And you might ask the question, well, what if my boss or what if my employer asks me to do something that's dishonest, or maybe asks me to do something that's unlawful? Well, if your boss instructs you to lie or to steal or to cheat or deceive in some way, then you can graciously and gently say to them, look, I cannot submit to that. Because at that point, you need to submit to the highest authority, which is God himself. And you don't want to go against what God says about lying and cheating and stealing. You don't want to do those things. But if there is no clash between the will of God and the will of your boss, the Bible says very clearly you must submit willingly to that instruction or whatever it is. So in our society, if a situation does become intolerable between you and your boss, I mean, you first of all need to submit to them, but if you are struggling with that, you have the freedom today, don't you, to look for another job, for an alternative job, and maybe that would be the wisest thing for you to do. But while you're in your job, under the authority of your current employer, you need to submit to them in everything. That's the first thing we pick out of this text here. The second thing that I want you to note is that we need to be pleasing. Look at what it says there. Bondservants are to be submissive to their own masters and everything, that they are to be well-pleasing. Well-pleasing. Pretty simple idea, right? To please your boss. It's interesting because when you look at this concept in the New Testament, every time we're called to be pleasing in the New Testament, every other reference in the New Testament is to be pleasing to God. This is the only one where it says we are to be pleasing to our boss, to those who are in authority over us. So this is pretty simple, right? You just need to work in such a way that your employer is going to be pleased with you, with the quality of your work, with your attitude, pleased with your effort. You need to be doing what you can to be well-pleasing. I mean, this is simply a commitment on your part to be excellent at what you do, to give it your best, to try your hardest in everything that you do at work. I mean, imagine if I was to visit your workplace this week and ask your boss for a reference about you. What would your employer write down on a piece of paper? You know, so-and-so is a conscientious employee or a hardworking employee or always on time. Yeah, they're a great worker, they're dedicated, they're very pleasing, they do a good job, they do everything faithfully. Would your employer say that about you? Or would they say, so-and-so is pretty haphazard, pretty lazy, half-hearted, always late to work, ill-disciplined? What would your boss say about you? What kind of reference would they give you? Because the call for a Christian here in verse 9 is that we are to be well-pleasing to our boss. Don't give him or her any evidence to suggest that you are not a faithful worker. That's pretty easy, right? That's the second thing we want to see. Be pleasing to your employer. The third thing in this text, again, straight out of there in end of verse 9, is that we are not to be argumentative. We are not to argue. A Christian employee is not to be argumentative. It's pretty simple. This, then, is a call for us to avoid grumbling or avoid complaining. You can't be resentful in your attitude or in your words. A Christian employee is not to be rude. You're not to be the kind of person that's just answering back and cheeky in any kind of way. You must work with the right spirit, with the right attitude. You're the kind of person that needs to be polite. You're the kind of person that needs to be respectful in the workplace. Even if you get assigned that job that you don't really want and nobody really wants it, you still need to do that efficiently and do it with the right attitude, without grumbling, without arguing, without answering back. That's what God would expect of us, His children, to do in the workforce. Just because your workmates may respond the wrong way, maybe your workmates would have a harsh word to say about your employer, you don't want to follow their example and slip down in your standards. Maybe this is something for you to think about as well. I've seen this in different contexts. Don't vent about your employer on social media. Not only is it a bad testimony for you personally and for Christ if you're a Christian, it will probably cost you your job one day, because employers are actually looking at social media as well. And I know that some actually do that to decide whether they'll employ you in the first place, and they might do that to see if they want to fire you as well. So just on a practical note, don't do it. It's just a bad testimony. It's not been a good Christian example. The Bible says, we looked at it last week, that we are to shine like lights in our community and in our world. And we certainly don't want to be having people point the finger at us because of the negative things that we're doing. So don't be argumentative. Number four in this passage, don't steal. Do not steal. Look at what it says there in verse 10. My translation says, not pilfering. Some translations might say, not embezzling. If you went back to the first century and you were in that slavery context, well, a lot of slaves were given positions, trustworthy positions. They were often left alone in homes to care for the homes, and they often had whole households to look after. And there were many, many opportunities where they could have just easily taken something from the house, slipped it into their pocket, taken food, taken some money, whatever it was. There were opportunities for that. So Paul says here, if you're a Christian slave, or if you're an employee who's a Christian, you need to operate with honesty and integrity. The eighth commandment applies to all of us. Do not steal. It applied to the first century slave, and it applies to the 21st century employee. And so we are not to steal. And maybe the idea is that petty theft. You just can't put your fingers in the till if you feel like it. And it's not right for you to take personal trips in the business car if you're not allowed to do that. It's not right for you to take a few bits and pieces of the office stationery if you're not allowed to do that. I mean, if you do those kind of things, it's unethical, and it's also stealing. If you don't have permission to borrow it or use it or take it, it's stealing. And we need to be mindful of that. And I think today that the easiest commodity for any of us to steal is time. Time. Do you spend half your day talking to your workmates instead of working? Are you on your phone to your friends when you should be working? Or what's worse, are you making calls to your friends that's actually not supposed to be happening, but actually costing the company money as well? Are you checking your emails and your Facebook when you're supposed to be working? All of those things are stealing time from your employer. Now, if he's happy or she's happy for you to do it, that's okay. But if you're not supposed to be doing it, it's stealing. You know, some people would never take $100 cash out of the work deposit box, but they would easily spend 3 or 4 hours a week wasting time doing things that they're not to be doing. I mean, God knows how you spend your time, and we're not to waste it. We're to use it wisely. And we're not to steal money, we're not to steal material things, we're not to steal time off our employers. Pulling sickies, you're not supposed to do that either. That's stealing from your boss, if you're not sick, that is. I mean, if you had to keep an account for every minute that you worked, what would that sheet look like? Are you a faithful employer? Don't steal from your boss. Let me give you the next one, the last one in this list. That is to be reliable. Verse 10, we're not to be pilfering, but showing all good faith. We're to be reliable, essentially, is what that means. And so the negative things that point 3 and point 4 talk about here are contrasted here in point 5. We are to show all good faith. And the idea here is that the slaves, or in our case, the employees, are to be trustworthy. You're to be a fully trustworthy person in the way that you work. You're to be a loyal employee. Some of you will know the story in the book of Genesis of Joseph. Remember, Joseph went off to Egypt. He was taken to Egypt. He was a slave in Egypt. And his Egyptian master trusted him so much that he could say in Genesis 39, he could say that he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. And because of him, he had no concern about anything. Is that the kind of person that you are, that your boss could go away and they would fully trust you to do what you're supposed to do if he's not watching you? That's the kind of work ethic we ought to have as Christians, that if the bosses are gone, if the workmates are all gone, that we would still do what God, what our boss would want us to do and what God would want us to do. It's as if we would work as if our boss was there watching us. Well, guess what? God is our ultimate boss, and he's there watching us anyway. So we need to work with a Christian ethic. We need to be reliable. We need to be trustworthy to show up to work on time. My friend Rick Holland would always say this to us when I was living in America. He would say, to be on time is to be late. So he always had that little motto in his head. I think his dad taught it to him, that if you arrive on time, you're actually late. You need to get there a few minutes earlier. I haven't heeded that in everything in my life, but it's a good principle to live by, that we need to be there on time, or at least just ahead of time. You know, if your workplace was to run a, you know, some of them do it, if it was to work or to run an employee of the month, you, as a Christian, should be a contender every month. Not that you would necessarily want your photo up on the screen or whatever for everyone to see, but you know what? Your trustworthiness, your faithfulness, your reliability, your conscientiousness, your hardworking attitude, being on time, being honest all the time, should put you in the running for that every month if there was such a thing happening at your place, your workplace. So you know what? It doesn't matter whether you're a cleaner, whether you're a teacher, whether you're a tradie, whether you're a doctor, whatever your employment is, you are called to be this kind of person. These are the qualities that you must have if you claim to be a Christian and you are in the workplace. Whatever your employment is. I mean, Colossians 3, 23 and 24 are great verses to think about as well in the context of working. It says there, whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. As I said earlier, our ultimate boss is God. He is the one that we need to please first and foremost, and he is the one who is watching us all of the time. So we need to please him with our work ethic. He is our, you could say, our divine boss. He is the ultimate one who has authority over us. And so we must please him no matter what. Remember that. Remember, God is always watching you, even if your boss isn't around. He knows your thoughts. He knows your words. He knows your actions. He knows how you use your time. But there's an important question that we need to ask as we look at this text. And that is, why should we live like this? Why should we live like this? And the simple answer is this. There's other answers, but this is the answer from the text. We are to live like this to make Christianity attractive. To make it attractive. Look at what it says at the end of verse 10 there. It gives a reason. It gives a purpose for living like this. It says, so that in everything they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. When we go to work as a Christian, we are sending a message to our boss and to our workmates about what Christianity is like. I remember last Sunday we talked a lot about this. We talked about the importance as Christians of living a godly life because the world is watching us and we are God's advertising agents for Christianity. Your life will either be an attraction or a distraction to Christianity. You will either make Christianity look good or you will make it look bad. And so the reason why we must display these five qualities is to enable our unbelieving friends, our unbelieving bosses, our unbelieving workmates, so that they would come to see that Christianity is something worth living for, something worth following. And notice what the verse says here, that they may adorn the doctrine of God. It's interesting, this word adorn, it's from the same word family as we get the word cosmetics. Now, cosmetics are designed to make a person look more attractive, right? You know, cosmetics are those wonderful, really expensive products that improve or repair a person's face, typically a female, right? This is... Us guys are just willing to put up with our defects and let everyone see them, right? So this is the word that Paul uses here. This word adorn is where we get this word cosmetics. And so the idea is this, is that we are to make Christianity look attractive. We want to make it look worth pursuing so that it maybe catches the eye. And we are to make God's word look attractive. And how do we do that? We do it by the way that we work. By the attitudes that we have at work, by our actions and our behavior in the workplace. All of these things are designed by God for us to make Christianity worth looking into. And so the divine cosmetics includes a Christian worker who is a submissive worker, an honest worker, a trustworthy worker, a reliable worker. These are designed to make Christianity look good, to look attractive and worthy of pursuit. And so the question that I really want to ask you this morning, for those of you who are Christians who work in the workforce, ask yourself, what kind of an example are you? What kind of message are you sending to your work friends? What kind of work ethic do you have? Do you have a Christian work ethic just like that? And I'm not saying put on a fake impression. Is it genuine? Do you genuinely desire to live like that and work like that? I think it would be true to say and sad to say that there are a lot of Christians who fail to live up to the standard that God calls us to. They unfortunately make Christianity look ugly. Their disrespectful attitudes, their grumbling, their complaining, their discontentment, their dishonesty, their lack of integrity, all of those things put a blight and a mark on Christianity. When the world watches you live like that, they become very skeptical of Christianity and the power of the gospel. You know what, the thing that makes a church attractive, the thing that makes the church attractive to a looking outside looking world, it's not the building, it's not a church strategy, it's not the programs we run, it's not our newspaper ads, it's not our website or anything like that. The thing that looks attractive to a watching world is the virtue and the holiness of the people who are in the church. And so our lives need to be a shining testimony to the world of God's grace and of His goodness in our lives. In other words, we need to be different, and we know that. We need to be different, and we need to make a difference in our world. So don't ever forget, you are, as a Christian, you are a living, breathing Bible for the people who are looking at your life. They're reading Christianity through your life. You are God's ambassador. And those who don't yet know Christ, they're looking at your life to judge whether they are interested in Christianity or not. So the question for all of us this morning is, what kind of an example am I? What kind of an example am I in my workplace? What is the world seeing? I want to finish with one little thing. Look at the very end of this verse. Notice that description of God at the end of this passage. It says, may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior. Do you know why we are to make Christianity look good? To look great? It's because God is our Savior. He is a saving God. And if you've got a Bible, you can just go down to the next verse in verse 11. It says there, we're going to look at this passage next week. It's a pretty awesome passage. For the grace of God has appeared, notice what it says, bringing salvation for all people. All people need a Savior. And it says here that God is our Savior. In fact, He is the only Savior. In fact, in the book of Titus, it mentions that point. It's a short letter, but it says it six times that God is a Savior. And we desperately need a Savior. This is good news for all of us because we desperately needed a Savior. The Bible tells us that our hearts are sinful. We have this bent to doing what is wrong. We have this bent to living ungodly lives and sinning and doing what is wrong. And the Bible says that is not good. And as a result of that, we're on a pathway to destruction. We're on a pathway to eternal punishment. All of us were like that in our lives. And if we don't do anything about it, the Bible says we cannot escape it. We're going to end up in destruction and eternity away from God. But thankfully, this verse reminds us that God is a Savior. God has a first-class rescue plan for all of us. He's got a plan to save us. You know, the Bible says one of the most well-known verses in the world, by the world, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, shall not end up on that road to destruction, but have eternal life. God is a Savior who saves us from going to eternal destruction and gives us the joy and the hope of having eternal life. That's a great message. That is the greatest message in all of the world. And the Bible says if we believe that message, if we believe that Jesus Christ came and died for us, that He rose again and that He is alive today, the Bible says if we believe that and we're willing to follow Christ, we will be saved and we will be in God's family for all eternity. That is an awesome message. And that is a great reminder as we look at the end of this verse that God is our Savior. And if we believe that message, we follow that message, then God gives us the ability to live like these five qualities up on the screen. We are to be submissive. We are to be pleasing. We're not to be argumentative. We're not to steal. We are to be reliable because when we do that, we will be a great testimony of Christianity in our workplaces. And I trust that God would help us and give us the ability to do that. Let's pray, and I think the guys are going to come up and lead us in one more song. Father, we just thank You for, once again, the practical reminder of Your Word. Lord, I pray that You would help us to be the kind of examples that You want us to be in the workplace. Help us to honor and respect those who are in authority over us. And we do that, Lord, because we want to honor and respect You, our great God and Savior. Thank You for rescuing us. Thank You for saving us from our sin. Thank You for giving us the hope of eternal life. Lord, help us to obey these commands so that we can honor You and so that You might be able to use it to show the attractiveness of Christianity. And I pray that You would do it and use it for Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.